Yadana! Welcome back to another Thursday Tahitian Moments Live. Thank you for those of you that are joining me live, and if you're watching a replay, again, thanks for taking the time to watch my videos. There are lots and lots of them on YouTube. I started April 1st doing these and have been doing them pretty much every Thursday since then. And they're going over really well. People enjoy them. So as long as I can make the time, which sometimes is tough, we will continue doing them so I can bring the beautiful images like this and information behind me here to you. If you don't know me, my name is Carl. I own and operate Tahiti by Carl. And what I do is I help travelers take the complexity out of planning and booking customized, memorable Tahitian vacations. Tahiti is not your normal, buy a package and go. And that's not the way you want to do such an exotic destination like this. So that's why you can come to me. I am here to help. I am experienced, seasoned, and very well connected. So I look forward to helping you get your trip to Tahiti booked. So today I've got a few different things we're going to talk about today. For those of you that are joining, we're going to go over some island updates. So last night I was very privileged and happy to have an exclusive invitation to a dinner event with Tahiti Tourisme. There was actually a team from Tahiti that were up in Canada. They're doing a stop in Vancouver, Toronto, and Montreal. And they invited me to join them for dinner just to get some updates. So we're going to run through a few of those updates and what took place last night. And then I'm super excited for all of you cruise lovers out there. You all know that Paul Gauguin is my favorite way to cruise, the Islands of Tahiti. If you follow my videos, you've heard that many times. We're not going to go through everything all about Paul Gauguin today, but I have Vicky joining me again from Paul Gauguin Cruises. If you go back to April, she was one of my very first guests on the show, and that's a very detailed video all about the cruise line. But sneak peek for you today, we're going to look at the 2023 cruise itineraries, which aren't even published on their website yet, but she's got a copy for me, and we're going to spill the beans on what's happening for 2023 and a few of the changes that they're making in some of the unique itineraries there. And then I've mentioned this in some of my other videos, and so I'm just going to go over it in a bit more detail today. I've got two videos that I'll show later on the humpback whales, because swimming with the humpback whales is such an incredibly unique Tahitian experience. And if you know me, I'm all about trying to give you that Tahitian experience when you go down to the islands. It's not just about the resort or the cruise ship that you're on. It's about what you do while you're there. And this is something that's truly unique. So we're going to talk a little bit more about the humpback whales. And after I mentioned it in some other videos, people asked to see some of my videos of when I swam with the humpbacks. So they're not professional by any stretch of the imagination, but we'll have a look at those. And then at the very end, I'm going to show you October's lineup, because I am for once super organized, and I have every Thursday for the month of October all booked. So I'll let you know who's coming on the show for the next month. And if you're interested in joining, you can join me for those events. So looking at, I just thought I'd put in this, I've been enjoying that. I always love travel quotes. So I just thought I'd try to pop in the travel quote maybe every Thursday as well. So this was one I came across by Hans Christian Andersen. And it says, to move, to breathe, to fly, to float, to roam the roads of land remote, to travel is to live. And that strikes a chord with me, and I think with a lot of my viewers that are watching here, because you know, travel is so much fun. It's so essential. It just, you know, it takes us out of our element. It takes us somewhere else. And it's truly my life. It's my business and it's my life and my passion. So I thought that was a really nice quote. So I thought I'd just start today's show off with that. But moving on, so this was just a couple photos from my event last night. It was really a nice night. I have to say, during COVID, especially here in Canada, we're a little bit more reserved than some of the other destinations. And this was my first live event that I have done in the tourism industry. And we usually, in my industry, do tons of live events. So it was really nice to get out and do something different. Of course, everybody fully vaccinated. But just this is, you know, myself. And this is Emily. Emily is the manager for Canada, with Tahiti Tourisme. So she would be the direct person that I go to work with for Tahiti Tourisme. She's new to the team. And then just some of the other people that came up, because it's really great to see the support. And I'm thrilled that I was invited to join them as well, because it's, it makes a difference, because I am working closely with Tahiti Tourisme on all sorts of events. But this here is Jean-Marc. He's actually the CEO of Tahiti Tourisme, based out of Tahiti. So he came up from Tahiti. Over here, this is Gina. She's a chief operating officer who also came all the way from Tahiti for the event. And then over on this side, over here, we have Rajella. And Rajella is the regional manager that covers all of North America. So it was so nice to have Rajella come up. I had dinner with her last time I was in Tahiti back in November. And then again, here is Emily. So four of them, three of them from Tahiti, and Emily's based out of Quebec. And then this is Nancy, who came up from New York. And Nancy is with Air Tahiti Nui. She's my representative with Air Tahiti Nui. So when I need help and I need information, then I go to Nancy for any of that. She's always a great support. So it's that team. And then these are a few other Tahiti travel specialists that were also at the dinner, but it was a very small and elite group. So I was very pleased to be with them. Next up, oops, I went the wrong direction. I do that all the time. So some of the things that we talked about that I just wanted to update you on, of course, during COVID, and if you know, if you've been on my other shows, Tahiti had the Delta variant, like everywhere in the world, hit. They had the huge spike. Numbers, as I reported last week, everything is going in the right direction and continues to go in the right direction. So it's fantastic. Cases are going down, hospitalizations, deaths, all going down. Vaccination rates continuing to go up. The government and Tahiti Tourisme are working to improve this even more. So one of the things that they do have coming out within probably the next month is going to be called the Safety Ambassador Program. And this is for the hotels and the tour operators when they are fully vaccinated and they abide by all the health and safety regulations that are recommended, they can be certified as a safety ambassador. And that's good for myself and for you as a traveler. If you're worried about doing certain tours or going to certain places, at a glance, we're going to know whether they are a safety ambassador or not, and whether they're abiding by all of those regulations. So it's a nice feature that they're putting in place. It's going to take a little while to get up and running because everybody's got to apply and meet all the criteria and so on and so forth. But probably, you know, within the next month, 2 months or so, I think they said a month, you know, I would say give it maybe 2 months. But that's something to watch for. And I, of course, will be updating for all of my travelers when we're doing quotes and putting programs together. I can let you know, who's on that list and who's not on that list to give you that extra peace of mind, you know, and I've said through all of this, you know, everybody's at different comfort levels. So you need to let me know where you're at so I can then give you the extra, you know, the extra information as well. Cause some people are like, hey, I don't care. I'm out of here. I'm gone. And other people are more worried and concerned. So whatever you're at, that's totally okay. Just let me know and we'll work together, but that'll be a nice new program that they've brought in. The current state of travel, these, like I say, are three people that have come up right from Tahiti, and that's their role, is to work with everybody, be it the Tahiti specialists like myself, but all the hoteliers and the smaller pensions, the tour operators. So they are the ones in the know, and things are going well, you know, so it's great to, you know, it's great to see. I mean, really, Tahiti has been a shining star from the beginning. You know, they've had the two different shutdowns, but they came out with very strict rules. They still have very strict rules. But the great thing is it works. You know, this case of the Delta variant and the rise that they had, none of it has been attributed to the travelers and the tourism. So it's fantastic. So we just have to continue on that track so that we can get out there and we can live and we can travel and we can enjoy when everybody feels comfortable. But it was nice to hear it from them that things are going very, very well down in the islands. And things are starting to, 2021, we had a lot of cancellations come in, but the hotels are getting very booked up and sold out again. So that's great to see and hear. Something else that was nice to see, Travel and Leisure Magazine has put out, they do a survey. So it's for their readers who vote on this. And so they did the top five resorts in South Pacific. And I was thrilled to see all five of them came from French Polynesia. Four of them in Bora Bora, and one of them being the Brando Tetiaroa, which is like the ultimate dream. So in that top five, there was the Intercontinental Thalasso, who, if you're following along with me, we'll have a show with them next month. So we got the Intercontinental Thalasso, the St. Regis Bora Bora, which you can find a past show, the Four Seasons Bora Bora, you can find a past show, the Conrad Bora Bora, also past show, and of course the Brando, which I did with Takora Kelly for a Brando. So all of those hotels, four of the five hotels that made it into the top, I've done shows on. You can find them in YouTube, in my archived video shows, and then the ones coming up next month. But I think that states a lot about the destination that, Fiji has some incredible resorts. There's some great resorts all through the South Pacific. But for the top five to all be voted in French Polynesia is really something special. New hotels coming soon, and then I put ish. there's been, unfortunately, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4 hotels in French Polynesia that currently are closed. So the Sofitel Tahiti is closed, the Sofitel Marara Bora Bora is closed, the Sofitel Private Island is closed. So those three properties are all closed. Good news is it looks like they have a buyer for those hotels. I'm sure once that deal goes through, which will take time, they need renovations and a lot of work and updating. So it's probably going to be a year or 2 years before they open, but I'm thrilled to hear that there's a buyer on the, in the works. Because honestly, we need the rooms down there in French Polynesia. There is a shortage. So don't come to me for last minute bookings because there's a shortage of rooms in Bora Bora. There's a shortage in Moorea. So we do need to book early for the hotel rooms for sure. And then there's a new hotel opening that's going to open in Tahiti. And that is the Hilton Tahiti Hotel, which will be a great hotel also for stopovers when you're doing cruises, pre and post, if you want a couple nights before the cruise or after the cruise, it'll be fantastic. And then just to see the main island of Tahiti, it's actually the first hotel I ever stayed at in French Polynesia back when it was a Sheraton and it was closed for years. It's been under renovation for quite some time now. And I heard last night that it is on track to open November 15th. And there is a sneak peek on that one on my Conrad Bora Bora video that I did a while back as well. At the very end of it, we did a little bit of an overview with some artist renderings, but I'm hoping to be down in November and experience that firsthand if it opens in time and coincides with my travels. And then the future focus of tourism. Last night it was good. We had some chats about where Tahiti is going with tourism. And, there's a lot of talk about climate change. And when you get a small destination like this, when the coral dies off and the ocean's warm, it has a great impact on them and their lifestyle. And there's also talk, for a while there was a talk about this big mega resort being built on Tahiti with a casino and all of this. I just thought it was horrible. I was mortified. Thankfully, that whole project got shut down. But the government and Tahiti Tourism have a strong focus now going into the future of a more sustainable travel style for the islands. So they're not looking at building any mega resorts. I talked last week about the large cruise ship ban. We're going to touch on that again a little later on today. But it is really nice to see that one of the beauties, the beauty of the islands is so visible, but the other beautiful part about the islands, it is the culture, it is the people. And if you start getting too much tourism going in, that can be destroyed. And we can see that in other destinations in the world. And I'm not going to name them, but I know I've been to them. If you go at the beginning of the season to some destinations, the people are lovely. If you go at the end of the season, the service is snarling and they're done and they're fed up with tourists. know, and that's sad. We don't want to see that happen in the islands because the Polynesians are great, great people. So this focus more of a sustainable tourism and a small scale side, I think, is the way to go. So that's really exciting to see and hear that that is their focus. I do just notice one comment that came in there earlier, and it was probably when I was on that quote screen. Thank you, Carol, for your comment. Beautiful. I think that was probably that lovely sunset picture that I had with the Paul Gauguin cruise ship, in there. Please remember, if you have any questions or comments, please drop them in the chat. Try to monitor that, and we'll get back to, and we'll mention them here. And we've got Tom here. I'm happy they're forward thinking that way. Yes, me too, Tom, for sure. Thanks again for joining. Yes, so what do I have next? I think next, So I go backwards all the time. This is a different presentation program I'm using. So I have, I'm just going to bring back onto the screen. I'm very happy we're able to do this little sneak peek, a little bit of, insider information here. But let me get Vicky from Paul Gauguin Cruises joining us here. There we go. Hello, Vicky.
Hi.
Thanks so much. How you doing?
Oh, great. Super. Yep.
And super excited that right now, as we speak, Paul Gauguin is cruising their first official cruise after the big long lockdown.
Yeah, well, we had a few sailings at the end of 2020. We actually did quite a few successful sailings. And then sort of as the world shut down, so did we. But just fabulous that we were back in the water. September 25th was our first sailing. And we're getting excellent reviews. So it's just so good to be able to say that.
Yeah. I was talking to another agent last night who had a group booked on it. And I said, so how are they doing? And she said, everything's been great. So that's, that's so nice to hear, it's, I think I saw, because there were definitely some people who, are shying away from cruises right now. Of course, Paul Gauguin is a small ship. It's not a mega ship.
Right.
But there was a quote that I saw in an article, which was so interesting. They talk about how nowhere are you going to go to shop where 100% of the people are going to be fully vaccinated, just tested or tested regularly while they're, while they're on board. Like, you don't get that when you go to your grocery store, or you go to Walmart, or you go, go shopping anywhere, or even for a walk in the park. So it truly is, when you think of it in that perspective, it is a much safer environment than a lot of the environments that some people put themselves in on a day-to-day basis,
And I think just even the size of our ship, because it is almost 20,000 tons, so it's quite a large vessel, but we only put no more than 332 guests on board. So we've always sort of had this, one of the terms that we were talking about, we're not crazy about, is that social distancing word. But, it's always been easy on the ship and in French Polynesia because, it's a large ship with very few people on board. And we are, all the crew are double vaccinated. All our guests are double vaccinated.
And we've always talked about the fact that that's one of the great things about Paul Gauguin. There's so much deck space and so much outdoor space because it was built for French Polynesia, and French Polynesia is all about the outdoors, not the indoors. Right.
So exactly. Yeah. And no matter what, the story of the show is always French Polynesia with us. Like, the ship is a great way to see the islands, but we're all about that authentic experience.
Nice. Just before I hop to the next slide, I'll just going to pop up here. We just had a couple other people say hello. Hello, Larry. Thank you again for joining every single week. As well as Dave, Vicky. Dave is rebooked to do his second trip down there with you. So,
fabulous!
Yeah. So, thanks again, Dave, for joining. Again, every single week. I've got so many loyal followers here that join every single week. Some on Facebook, some on Twitter, some on YouTube, and it's nice. I really quite enjoy it. So
that's good. You've changed it up a lot. Like, every week, it's something new. So I think that's why you keep.
Yeah. I'm trying to. And that's for anybody that's watching this as well. Please, I've got all of October booked up. But please, if you have ideas of things you'd like to see and you'd like to hear about, I am so open to that. because it's, you know, it's I enjoy doing these and I enjoy having the guests too. If any of my past clients want to join, let me know. I'll gladly bring you on the show. You know, we can have a little chat one day. Like, it's, you know, it's nice just to do something, you know, do something a little different every Thursday. So
That's great.
Okay, so let's have a look here. Let's see if I go forward or if I go back.
I mean, really exciting that we're actually showing you a 2023 schedule. And like you said, it's not even our reservations office actually can't even book these date voyages for you yet. It will be any day now in the next few weeks where we'll be up and running with reservations. Yeah. But this is great. So you can kind of take a look. I mean, we've been the longest continually sailing ship in French Polynesia. So we don't change really much from year to year because we're quite successful at what we've done. But
yeah,
if you look at the past few years and you look at 2023, I think you'll definitely see there's a change toward longer sailings. And you mentioned
this. I looked at this, I'm like, holy, there's not very many seven-nighters.
Yeah, yeah. And when we came up with our 2022 schedule, that's what we saw right away is the longer sailings were being booked up and lots more group travel as well that we're doing. And I think that's probably because the last year and a half, we've all been, you know, pent up in our houses with our, you know, immediate family and friend or no friends.
Yeah.
And now when we're finally able to travel, we want to travel with friends and with other family members. And yeah, so there's a change we're seeing that way as well.
I think we're going to go back to, you know, it was a trend that we saw after 9/11, you know, that people were more into creating experiences and memories and things important to them and socializing with their friends and family than they were the material things.
Right.
I feel like this is another, you know, another step that we're going to go forward in the next, 4 to 5 years with that as well. So
yeah, I agree completely.
Yeah.
So you'll see that reflected when we look at the itineraries that we're doing. We used to only do sail to Fiji every second year.
Hmm.
We would find that if we had Fiji every year, it wouldn't sell very well.
Yeah.
But now for the last 3 years, we've been offering Fiji. And I think you'll see this and then even the longer sailing here we have with the Fiji Bali itinerary that we're doing as well.
Nice.
So we do, you know, year round, we've done our 7 day sailing, which is really, it's the quintessential Polynesia. 7 days, you overnight in Bora Bora, you overnight in Moorea. We have a full day at our private retreat, which is Taha, which is, you know, absolutely. It's one of the best experiences. You always think Bora Bora and Moorea are going to be the highlights, but really it's when you're in our private beach, Motu Mahana in Taha.
It's great. Yeah, it's a great.
And then Huaheine too on that itinerary. So they have lots of archaeological sites. Yeah.
And if I can just chime in there too, I mean, I think this is the one thing. If anybody's watching this and didn't catch the show 2 weeks ago, Vicky wasn't with me, but I did one just on the group sailings that I have with Paul Gauguin. And I mean, I think the real benefit for people to work with me on the cruise side, you know, a cruise is easy for any travel agent in the world to book. That's not hard. But where a Tahiti specialist like myself comes in is when you've got that 7 night sailing, you know, we can do a couple nights before, we can do overwater bungalows afterwards. I mean, on any of them, right? But it's, and I also work, you know, I spend over an hour on the phone with clients that are going in October, and we planned out every one of their excursions for every single island. So I know that they've got a nice mix to get the cultural side, but to get the fun jet ski side to, you know, because I know the islands and what's sort of best on which.
Well, you know what I know you do that a lot of travel advisors don't do, frankly, is you spend a lot of time talking to people to find out their expectations, their comfort levels, you know, what they're really looking for in their vacation. And then you custom make something for them.
Yes.
So, you know, kudos to you. Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, that's, yeah, for sure. That's everything I want to do. I want to do customized. I don't want somebody to have the exact same experience if they're not the same type of people. So
So for some people, 7 days might be great. For others, they're looking at our longer sailings.
Yeah.
And a couple I'll just point out here that we have is the from Tahiti into Fiji, which is that itinerary sold out in about a month when we came out with it for 2022.
Which one is that? This one?
From Saidi Islands to Fiji.
Yeah, and that's an interesting one.
Yeah, because you go across four very different archipelagos. And you sail into Tonga. You know, Tonga is the only island, group of islands, that was never colonized by the Europeans.
Yeah.
So it has its own monarchy. So for if you're a destination bucket list collector, Tonga is very difficult
for
to
sure.
get. It's a unique itinerary that way. There's a few days at sea. So, you know, some folks I love days at sea personally. Some folks, you know, they want more time in the destination. So that's part of it too. It depends if you like lots of days at sea.
Yeah.
But the other unique itinerary that we have, and this is truly a one-off, we only do this maybe every 4 years, is that Fiji to Bali and return. Mm. And I actually don't even have the day-by-day itinerary on that, but I know it'll be an epic voyage. We've done it before. It's usually really exotic ports like Vanuatu, Solomon Islands, Papua New Guinea, into Indonesia. And so you get to see lots of historical sites and ancient cultures and great beaches, but then you get centuries-old civilizations as well. So it's unique in that you get so much diversity.
And I bet, I don't know for sure, but I bet for all three of those sailings that we're talking about, you get a lot of repeat guests on those ones.
Yeah, that's absolutely it. Yeah, a lot of our guests that have traveled. Well, a lot of folks will do that seven-day itinerary on their first sailing, and then from there they really start to realize that, you know, a lot of folks think, well, French Polynesia or the South Pacific, it's all the same. Mm-hmm. But then when you get there, you realize, oh my goodness, the Tuamotus, they're so different than the Marquesas.
For sure.
The Marquesas,
the Cook Islands and the Fiji and Tonga and all that into the mix, they're all completely different, right?
Exactly. So I think they get a taste of it and then they want to go back and try something longer for sure.
Yeah.
So that's definitely what we're focusing on for 2023.
And for February, the ship's just sleeping.
We're going to do a dry dock again. And we're going to talk today about the dry dock that we just have now.
Yeah.
I couldn't even begin to tell you what's happening with the dry dock in 2023. We're just starting to get pictures of our dry dock that we did this year. You know, with just being able to sail now, we haven't been able to send a film crew down to get pictures on board the ship. The dry dock was done in March, but all of the public areas were covered up. So we've had crew on the ship, right? The ship's been in Polynesia, but everything's covered up. So we couldn't even have photos or anything like that.
Yeah.
So the next time we talk, I'll have lots of pictures of the dry dock for you.
Sweet. Good, good, good. Unless I get on there first and take my own.
You, at this rate, you probably will.
So that's nice. The whole of January, March sailing is very, very interesting. And then we kind of roll into more of the classic itineraries, I guess, right?
And not to downplay those. It's just those are the ones we've done every year, and we're really successful at it. So
they're fantastic.
Same old in a good way.
And I mean, for sure. And I mean, I think like some of the ones that have been hot items again this, like, for current, you know, available for sale for 2021 and 2022. You know, the Marquesas and Tuamotus selling really well, right? Again, the longer itineraries. You know, for me and my clients, the 7 nights tend to be very popular as well. Cause like I said, I got a lot of people that are, you know, we're doing the pre and post on. So it ends up being a 14 nights by the time you add the pre and post. But lots of good options there. So one of the things that I work with Vicky on doing is I block group space every year, so we can have a price advantage. And that presentation I did 2 weeks ago, you know, went over all of that. But for 2023, I will be blocking groups as well as soon as they're soon. Like I said, this is truly a sneak peek because they're not ready for us yet. We don't have the exact pricing. We don't have the full itineraries. You know, this is kind of what we've got. But I already have in mind some of the ones that I'm thinking about blocking space on. And I'll be working with Vicky as soon as we can to get that blocked, because then we get a savings of up to what?
Well, last year it was 30%.
Yeah.
Plus the group discount, the bonus for groups as well. So it was up to 35% on sailings.
Yeah.
And it really is with our dynamic pricing model that we have, we do come out with the best prices early on. And then as the sailings start to fill, the prices increase. And It works very well when we're looking at 2022. Our occupancy levels, like I said, are extremely high for 2022.
Yeah. Just a couple more comments I'll pop in here that people commented. Dave, thank you very much for your
kind
words. I really appreciate that. I know he loved the first time and he's excited for his second time. And then the other man who I know who is super excited to go, and this would be Kevin. Kevin, thank you. Kevin's watching from Philadelphia, and we have an option held on for Kevin for 2023. Yes, Kevin.
Yes.
The one I emailed you about.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Kevin, we were so excited because when Carl mentioned it, I was like, I don't even know if we can even make a booking at this point, but we did, but we have no idea what the prices are, but we're getting that for you any day now.
Yes. So Kevin is, he told me he was bursting at the seams knowing that this trip is finally in the works for him, which I totally understand because I get so excited when I finally get down to planning to get planning.
I always need to have that trip in the, to work towards, right?
Yeah, exactly. So what do we have next up?
Our sale of confidence. Yeah. And this is, I love this policy because really what it comes down to is final payment isn't due until 30 days before you travel. So it just gives you the ability to, and if at that point you can cancel for any reason, your deposit goes towards a future travel credit. Mm-hmm. And for any reason you can cancel at that point. Yeah. So I think it just gives you the peace of mind to know that you have until the last minute to decide whatever comes up, if you're comfortable traveling still or not.
And I just want to comment, because I work with a lot of different suppliers for travel all over the world. How much I love this, because with the Delta variant and who knows what the world could toss our way in the future, hopefully nothing but good stuff. I think we all deserve that. But 30 days is great because we don't know when somebody says final payment is due 60, 90 days prior, a lot can change in 90 days or 60 days. So 30 days is really really good. And honestly, I think it's unheard of. I don't think any other cruise line is offering.
Oh, good. That's good to know.
Not that I know of. I don't know. I'm not 100%.
We were always 90 days before our final payment used to be 90 days prior to departure. So
it's really good. And I think that's one of the beautiful things with Tahiti is that being a small destination, even when I do the land package to go with the cruise side, when we had this Delta spike, final payment was supposed to be 60 days prior, but I was able to push that back for everybody because it's like, let's wait and see what happens,
Yeah.
So it being a smaller destination, it's nice so I can have a little bit of flexibility on some of those things. So.
Right. And we've just extended that for bookings. It was supposed to end at the end of September. We've extended it till the end of December. So if you mm-hmm. book it for the end of December, and it only shows, you were asking me about it. It only shows till the sailing until the end of December of 2022. And the reason for that, we don't have our 2023 out yet. So I fully expect that when we come out with 2023 in the next couple of weeks, that will be final payment due 30 days prior to.
Yeah, which will be amazing. That'd be really, really, really
good. I'll be surprised if it isn't, but
I'll
be sure to let you know.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. Good. Yeah. So dry dock. Let's talk about the dry dock a little bit. We mentioned briefly.
Yeah, well, it's so exciting because we're scheduled to do the dry dock in May of 2020. And of course, that couldn't happen. And so it was completed in March of 2021 and in Singapore. And there were key upgrades that we had on board, but one of the largest or most important was a large environmental upgrade. And it's in line with the thoughts of our parent company, which is Panon. And Panon are they're the only cruise line that sails under the French flag. They have all small ship, small capacity vessels, and they are all on the cutting edge of technology and environmental preservation. Of course, as you can imagine, preserving this pristine environment, as you were talking about, Carl, it's so important moving forward, right? So what we want to do is minimize the impact on the environment. And so the very important thing that we did was we eliminated the use of heavy oil fuel. And we also committed to offsetting 150% of our carbon emissions on board the vessel. Yeah. Yeah.
That's great. That's that's really good, you know, because the islands, you know, along with the, like I just said, with the mentality of the government going forward, but the resorts have so many great environmental moves, like, you know, so many of them are all not fully solar operated, but they have, you know, solar power supplementing the energy. And if you look at the bungalows, they've got the solar panels up top, you know, right. The Intercontinental, the Lasso, and the Brando have
the Brando. Yeah. You mentioned that. I mean, no one does it really like the Brando, right?
The Brando is like 100% environmentally friendly, running off of coconut oil. But what I love is their air conditioners as well. They use the deep sea water. They pump the cold water in through the pipes, and that's what's used to air condition all of the rooms.
Yeah.
And you know, I don't know the whole ins and outs of how it works, but it's amazing. And the air conditioners are also completely silent, you know, so you don't hear these things clicking on and off all the time. Right. So there's some really good environmental things going, you know, going forward there. And on that note, we have a short video here that's not specific to Paul Gauguin, but specific to their parent company, Ponant Cruises, like Vicky just said. It's only, I think it was about a minute long, Vicky. So
yeah, I don't even think it's a minute, but it has just beautiful imagery too. So I think it's worth a quick look.
Yeah, so that's just because we've been on this environmental topic. So I'll just put this on for a minute so we can all enjoy and then be right back. Very nice.
I love that quote. We protect best what we know well. That's lovely. True,
right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. And it's just, I watched that video, man, it makes me want to get on a plane.
I almost get choked up when I see that because it's just so beautiful, right?
Yeah. And I love to explore the world. You know, I've been to over 70 countries and it's just, you know, it just makes me want to go. But let's take a look here at, we've got a few images.
Yeah, this is where I was hoping to have a million images to show you of the, but like we said, we're going to have them next time.
Yeah.
But just know all of the public areas. So anyone that's been on board the ship will notice a difference in the public areas and in the stateroom. So everything has been upgraded. And the vision of the renovation really was to enhance the Polynesian look and feel on board and keep it very casually elegant and a fresh style. If you look at the Ponant vessels, I've been on 75 cruises. I've loved every cruise I've ever been on, but I was on Le Champlain, I guess it's 2 years ago now. It's the most beautiful vessel I've ever seen in my life. Mm. And this is really fitting with, the beautiful, classy sort of French style all of the public areas and the staterooms. And you can see the color palette. And Carol, we were talking earlier, and you mentioned this too on the next slide. What we've done is we've incorporated the colors from the lagoons with a wide range of green and natural tones and warm colors. And what we've done, this actually, you and I were on board, I guess it's maybe about 5 years ago.
Yeah.
One of the things that you commented, we were sitting by the pool and you said, you know, what you really haven't done is incorporated a lot of the tapestry and the artwork and the tattoo look and that sort of look of the islands. And that's something that has definitely been done on board the vessel now. So we've added traditional artwork. There is a virtual museum with over 150 paintings of Paul Gauguin.
Yeah.
One of the things that we've done that people are most excited about is complimentary Wi-Fi.
Everybody loves it. you have to put your social media shots on, right?
Exactly. I think it's good. Yeah. I hope people aren't streaming videos. I hope it's to send pictures home to say wish you were here. But
you're not working, right?
Yeah, exactly.
I love this next shot. This is the shot that I really love.
Yeah. So you can see what we've done is taken the colors from outside the islands and brought them on board the ship and vice versa. And lots of big open windows.
Yeah, because this picture I really find shows the beauty of it. You know, like we say, the beauty of French Polynesia is out there, but even when you're inside here, how you still get those, you know, get those amazing views there of Bora Bora in this shot. So it's really, really, really nice.
And lots of outdoor dining areas as well. Lots of covered areas too. So outdoors is great as well. So
Yeah. We have a few more questions and comments. Larry commented that our video was not long enough for him. I'm sure Pinon has a lot more other beautiful long ones too we could probably find for you, Larry. Carol, thanks so much for joining. She enjoyed that clip as well. It really is well produced. And then we've got a great question here from Seeking Lava. Is Pinot planning to send any new ships to French Polynesia in the near future?
Yeah, you know, it's a great idea. They do have some vessels sort of periodically. Le Levant, I think at one point we had gone through. So there were some plans. I have to admit, I only represent Paul Gauguin, not Pinot, even though they are our parent company. But there was talk 2 years ago. They were building us two brand new vessels. And we're not talking a lot about it now, but I think it's still in the works because they have built new vessels in the last while. But the talk was always 180 guest ships, so smaller than the Paul Gauguin, but based out of French Polynesia as well, possibly doing Australia, Bali, Fiji, maybe Asia, that kind of thing. As for actual itineraries into right now, I don't know, but Carl can find that out for you. We can follow up and find out. But it's not like us where we're year-round with a ship in French Polynesia. This is all we've done for more than 20 years. Yeah. So we are absolutely the destination experts in this part of the world.
Yeah.
But we're taking advantage of different things with the brand for sure. Like I was just I was listening to someone who was saying that one of the lectures on board the sailing right now is a Pinot lecturer that had been on 10 sailings with I'd worked for 10 years with Pinot, but now they're doing lectures on board our ship on this. There are special guest hosts on board, so we're using guest hosts from Pinot as well, so we'll take advantage of things like that as well.
Nice. Just going to move along here because it's amazing how time flies by. So just a quick reminder, once again, I have all of these from 2 weeks ago. So it's on the YouTube from 2 weeks ago. But these are the special promotional rates that I have for 2022. So the April 9th sailing, which is a 14-night Marquesas sailing, which is almost sold out, right, Vicky? There's not very
much space left
on that one at all.
I think pretty much all of them that you have, except the November 5th, oddly enough. You know, I only say because we're really quite booked out. No, July maybe has.
July is set. So these three are all going to be the classic 7-night itinerary doing Huahine, Motumahana, Bora Bora, and Moorea for all three of those, the same itinerary. The July 23rd still has a lot of space on it.
April, that was the one that was
quite booked. And November is about 50% booked. And I mean, if we look at why, this could be out of date now, because I did this on September 16th. But you can
be really close. I think we had a few dates that the prices have gone up since then.
Yeah. But this is the savings that people can get. You can save $800 US per person on a category C balcony cabin with the special pricing that I've got here.
You know, and this is just because you took advantage and got on board early and made your group bookings. Same as we're going to do with you for 2023. So it's great.
Oh, are you back?
Yep.
Oh, there we go. Sorry, internet glitch. I haven't had that for a few shows, but it happens. So we're just saying we've got some really, really good savings, you know, on these dates. So, but I feel like we don't know the 2023 pricing yet, but I feel like you're not going to get a category C balcony for $3,300 US in 2023.
Well, you know, with the way how things are progressing, like we're really busy for 2022. So,
yeah.
But like I said, we did have a 30% bonus discount right out of the gate for 2022. I keep mixing up my numbers, right? For those bookings. So
yeah.
I think if people get on it early and, like I say, pay a deposit, you don't have to pay your final payment until 30 days before you go.
Yeah.
I think that's the way to go about it.
Yeah,
now.
For sure. If anybody's interested in the 2023 sailings, please just shoot me an email. Let me know what you're looking at. We can talk. And then as soon as everything is fully operational, you know, I'll be in touch and we can get stuff booked and blocked for you. So then the last thing I just wanted to say is smaller is better. You know, let's focus on the sustainable tourism and the new rules that come into place in 2022 with French Polynesia is no ships over 3,500 passengers, which is amazing. And Bora Bora is a maximum of 1,200 passengers in a day, which is by far plenty. I'd be happy if they even cut that down lower, but that's okay. You know, so it's really nice going that direction. It's not, and like you, Vicky, I love to cruise. I've been on the world's biggest. I've been on some of the smallest, you know, and I truly do enjoy anything. But in French Polynesia, you do not want to be on a ship with thousands of people. It's not. Right.
And the islands just aren't made for it. And yeah. What you'll see with us is often we'll come up with our schedules. Like you see, we're talking about 2 years in advance, but then we'll see another cruise line all of a sudden decides that they're going to come into Bora Bora on a big ship on the same day we are. So then we're nimble enough that we just change and say, oh, no, we're going to go to Huaheine on this day and then be in Bora Bora when the big ships aren't going to be there. So
we've
always had the ability to do that as well, but this is very good for tourism.
Yeah, very, very good. So yeah, I'm very happy. So we'll see more and more of that coming out as the whole government and country change their focus on future tourism. But it's definitely steps in the right direction and to help battle this climate change and, you know, allow us to travel, but let's do it in a responsible manner. So it's, I'm quite happy and very excited about the changes that Paul Gauguin has made to the ship as well to help protect the environment. So that's awesome. So good. Okay. Well, thank you so much, Vicky, for joining me.
It's always my pleasure. I really enjoy it. I'm looking forward to coming back and I'll be in the background. I'm staying on till the end. So if anyone has questions,
yes,
comments, I'll be available to answer them as well.
Yeah. Yeah. Shoot. If you have any questions, drop them in the question box. And I'm going to toss Vicky backstage now, but again, thanks so much for joining me. And then we're going to move on and talk about the whales of French Polynesia. Okay. Thanks, Vicky.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
So French Polynesia as, oops, sorry, I'm going backwards again. See, I do it every time. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about, I thought I'd try to highlight on some of my live events, you know, some of the authentic Polynesian experiences you can have. And I've done some shows just on this, but I mentioned this a couple times in different episodes and people have asked me, well, what's it like? And we see you talking about the whales. So I thought I would just do a little bit of a talk here on the humpback whales. As far as I know, there's only two places in the world where the laws still allow you to swim with the humpback whales. And in French Polynesia, it is regulated. It has to be with licensed guides, but it's one of the places that you can still do it. And the other, I believe, is in Tonga, which we just talked about. You could go on Paul Gauguin cruise. I'm not sure if they're there during whale season, though. Probably not. If they're doing early season, I don't think the whales will be around. But so in French Polynesia, it is something really unique that you can do. And I've had the fortune of doing it twice when I've been down there. I did it once in Tahiti and I did it once in Moorea. You can also do it in Bora Bora, And you can also do it if you're staying in the Brando. They do it there in the Brando. And then one of the best places to do it is in Rutshuru, which is not that they don't have any resorts. So it's very small pensions and guest houses. So most people that would go there would really have to be die hard for the whales. But that is an option if you were ever interested. We could, you know, we could do that. But you have to book well in advance, because we're talking guest houses that have, you know, four rooms and another one that has eight rooms. And boy, they sell out quick. But we can definitely do it from Tahiti, Moorea, or Bora Bora. I recommend Tahiti and Moorea. They seem to be more consistent viewings of the whales. So the whales come every year, and your whale season is going to be usually around late June to November. Now, we never know exactly because it's Mother Nature and it depends, but around that season is the time frame. So the first time I did it, I was staying at the Intercontinental Tahiti Hotel. I used Top Dive, who are excellent. Again, there's a whole episode on diving in French Polynesia with Sebastian from Top Dive. You can go back and watch, and we talk a little bit about the whales there. But they've got a dive outfit right there at the Intercontinental Hotel. So you literally walk down, get on their boats, their nice professional dive boats, and off you go. Now, one thing that's important to know when you're doing the whales is it's not often that the whales are inside the lagoon. They're pretty much always outside the lagoon in the open South Pacific. It can be rougher out there. You look at where Tahiti is on the map, it's in the middle of the ocean. So if you're not a comfortable swimmer, you have to decide whether it's for you or not for you. You can always go. The first time I did it, my parents came with me. They didn't get in the water. They just came on the boat to watch, because you see the whale tails, you see the whales breach, you know, depending on what's going on with the whales. It's nature. We don't know for sure. But you could always go and then decide at that point in time if you want to get in the water or not. But wow, it was such an incredible experience when I did it. So I have two different videos to show you. So the first video I'll show here is when I did it in Tahiti with Top Dive. We saw a mother and her calf. So we first saw the whales jumping and playing and swimming around, which was incredible. But if the whales are too active, you can't actually swim with them. So there's no guarantees you'll be able to swim with them, because when these whales move, they flick their tail and they're gone. Like, you can't keep up with them. And the mother has to be comfortable with the young, so that she doesn't, you know, run off when you get in the water. So typically later in the season, you tend to have better odds of swimming with them, because the mother is more, she's more relaxed because her young is a little bit older. And the young are great because they're very curious and inquisitive. So they tend to be interested in who's in the water with them. So the first time we did it, we saw them, and then the whales kind of slowed down and the guy goes, okay, this is it. We get in the water. He was very specific that we had to form a line and never be ahead of him to protect the whales. So we get in the water, you swim, you're snorkeling, you're in the open South Pacific, it's deep, but the water is super clear. And I'm out there and I'm staring down and I see white and I think, wow, this water is so clear. You can see the sand in the bottom, even though we're so deep out here in the, you know, in the South Pacific Ocean. It's just fascinating. And all of a sudden that white moves, and that white that I was looking at was the white of a whale. And I was just like, oh my gosh, that's the whale. And I actually kind of panicked a little bit because they are so big. Like, I wrote down here that the mothers can weigh up to 40 tons and be up to 60 feet long. The young can be up to a ton and 10 to 15 feet long. So they are massive. So when it started to move, I was like, oh my gosh, I hope it's not going to, you know, come up and hit me. But of course the guide had us behind and the whale was in front and it was down low. And then when they swim, they go up, you know, on an angle. It's not like they're not like a submarine. But I'll just put on the video and I'll show you what my experience was. And keep in mind that this is not a professional video. This was done on a tiny, crappy Olympus point and shoot camera that I swear before I go next, I'm going to get myself a good GoPro, so I can have a better quality underwater, you know, underwater shots. But let me just show you a video here. It's just, I think it's a minute and a half long, maybe 2 minutes long, of what my experience was. Thank you. that just gives me chills watching it again, because it was such a special wildlife moment for me. I mean, that baby humpback at the end just came and swam. I mean, I could have, you can't, of course, but I could have reached out and touched the baby. At one point we saw the mother's milk floating, you know, floating in the water as well. So it was really fantastic. And you saw they went up, they flicked their tails, and then they dove down, and then they were, and then that was it. That was gone. But that was just so special for me. It was incredible. Now, it's not always that way, though. So when I went my second time, which was just last November when I was down, I went Moorea, and we went out looking for the whales, but it was a rough day. And we found the whales, and we could see the tails, and you could see them. But by the time you get in the water, it was tough, because the boat has to stay a certain distance from the whales. So you have to get in the water, and you do have to swim. But the waves were crashing on our heads, and some people are spitting water and they're getting mouthfuls of seawater. And so it was good exercise, you know? And then we get back in the boat and didn't see them. So that happened, I think, three or four times with no luck in actually seeing them. We see them from the boat, but not in the water. So it's important to know, if you do want to do the whales, that, you know, you never know what's, you know, what it's going to be. So what you'll see. So important to tell me too, when we're planning your trip, if you really want, if this whale experience is like so, so important to you, we should book it like maybe once in Tahiti, once in Moorea. So you can have two different experiences. And, or maybe we just do it once at the beginning of your trip. And if it doesn't work out for you, you can try to book again directly with the resort for a, you know, for a second time. But my, so after we didn't have success seeing them, we took the boat around the other side of the island looking for the dolphins, where the water was calmer because it was quite rough. We get around to the other side of the island, and lo and behold, what all of a sudden jumps up? A humpback whale, which we didn't think we were gonna see at all. We thought we were gonna see the dolphins, which we didn't see. We saw the humpback whale. This time we got in the water, and in this video, you will barely see the humpback, but what you will hear is amazing, because this was one of the males, and the males, they call them the singers. So the male, the sounds that you make in the second you put your ear underwater, it was so clear. So this is more not about what you see, but about what you hear. So have a listen here. Unreal, eh? It's just, it was just such a completely different experience. And that's nature. You never know what, you know, what you will get. But that's the two times that I've swam with the humpbacks, and I will do it again some other day, because it's just so unique, and they're just these big gentle giants. So if that's something you'd want to add to your trip, please, please, please let me know, and we can plan plan that. And I already have somebody signing up for Larry. I am still behind on your itinerary, which is for 2023, but I will mental note that we need to get the whales into your itinerary. And then another comment here, I'm getting tears in my eyes listening to the whale song. It's special, eh? It's just it's almost haunting. What struck me was how incredibly loud it was. It was just really, really wild. And I have a question here from Vicky also. Isn't there certain times of the year that the whales migrate through the islands? Yeah. So the whale season is in June is, you know, kind of the start of it, June until November. And we never know how long in November and how early in June, but that's sort of the time range. And like I say, the best time for actually swimming with them is going to be towards the end of that, because they come in and they're going to give birth to the babies. And when the babies are really young, the mothers are unsettled, and you know, it's not as easy to get in the water and get in the water with them. So that is what they have. We're staying Seeking Lava. What do we say here? We're staying in Bora Bora. Do they offer humpback whale swim tours there as well? Yes, they do. They do. You can get humpback whale tours from Bora Bora as well, for sure. For sure. I don't know if they always have as many whales out around Bora Bora, though. That's why I usually recommend it in Tahiti and Moorea, but definitely well worth, you know, well worth doing if you're there during the whale season. So next thing I just wanted to touch base on before we wrap it up here, because I am at the hour already. October live events. Sometimes I'm a little fly by the seat of my pants with these because I'm trying to organize things and I get super busy booking and planning all these great trips for everybody that I fall behind on this. But I am organized for October. And if you like the looks of this overwater bungalow, then you need to join me next week. This truly, in my opinion, gives you the best views of any overwater bungalow in all of French Polynesia. And this is at the Intercontinental Thalasso Hotel. And I will have them with me. This is my schedule for October. So October 7th, we do have the Intercontinental Thalasso Bora Bora. I have Catherine joining me. October 14th, I have Yvette joining me. She will be coming live from Moorea. So Yvette is one of my operators that any of my past clients will probably know if you've done tours with Yvette. I always nickname her the Energizer Bunny because she has so much energy. Like when you go on a tour with her, she is going to teach you as much as she possibly can in that time frame. October 21st, I have Catherine coming back a second time because she does three properties. So we're going to cover the other two properties being the Intercontinental Tahiti, which I use a lot of with my clients for, you know, pre, post, the beginning of your trips right there in Tahiti. It's close to the airport, very comfortable, great hotel. And then the Intercontinental Moana Bora Bora, which is a really nice four-star option on the mainland. So we'll cover those two hotels on October 21st. And then October 28th, for the first time, I'm doing an airline. So I'm very happy. Nancy, you guys showed the picture up earlier in the presentation. Nancy is joining me October 28th to talk about Air Tahiti Nui. Because Air Tahiti Nui gives you that Polynesian experience from the time you step on board in LA to the time you get off the plane. It sort of extends your Tahitian vacation that little bit more. Thank you guys. I'm glad you enjoyed the videos and the day. Please, anybody watching this, if you are enjoying things, it helps me a lot if you don't mind liking the video, comment, share, subscribe to the YouTube channel. Google's a big monster. I'm a small little guy, and you know, and I like to try to get some new business from people here by doing this, so that really helps and makes a difference to me. So if you are enjoying them, please let me know by dropping a comment, liking, or subscribing on YouTube would be fantastic. And for anybody looking at going to French Polynesia, please reach out to me. You know, my website, tahitibycarl.com, is there. The sample packages on there. I do plan on updating the sample packages this fall. I've just been so busy. I haven't had a chance, but I will be looking at doing that. And yes, and we can work on starting to plan your dream Tahitian vacation. So thank you very much once again for joining me. I hope that you all come back again next week. And remember, there are tons of these that you can watch the previous episodes on my YouTube channel, youtube.com/TahitiByCarl. Maruru, and as they say in Tahiti, goodbye, which is nana.